bij mijn man, die eigenlijk het terrein hier van Werchter waarschijnlijk beter kent dan de mensen die hier elk jaar naartoe komen. Niemand minder dan Moby. Hi.
Hi.
How are you doing?
I'm fine, thanks. How are
How's life been treating you? I'm good, thanks.
Life has been fine. I mean, I don't have all that much to report. I was here a year ago.
You were, yeah.
And
you look less jet-lagged than you did then.
Really?
Yes, you do. You were so tired back then.
Oh, yeah. I've been here for a little while. I've been in Europe for now for about 2 weeks. And but in the last year, I was touring, and I went back to New York, and I made this record, and now I'm touring again. And it's a little bit like Groundhog Day, but a nice, you know the Bill Murray movie?
Mm-hmm.
But a nice version of Groundhog Day.
Cool. Well, it's always nice to have you here.
Thank you.
You're playing at the Tewi Classic Festival, which is kind of different than the Rock Werchter Festival because you have the name Classic in it. Do you feel that you have to like play all your hits today because it's kind of what people are expecting? But you have this new record out and
I like playing hits at festivals because it's nice to see 60,000 people jump up and down.
Mm-hmm.
I'm putting a new record in a couple of weeks called Wait For Me, and it's a much quieter record and more emotional, more melodic, and I'll be playing some of those songs today. But as we both know, festivals are not necessarily the best place to try out new music, especially new quieter music. So yeah, it's a greatest hits show, and hopefully people will like it.
With 9 people on stage, is that correct?
I think so. There are a lot of people on stage. I haven't counted. I think there are 9 people on stage. Yeah.
So there might be one missing later and you won't even notice.
Yeah. It's like when you have a really large family and all of a sudden you realize one of the children's missing. You're like, oh, how long have they been gone? 6 months? Wow, I didn't know.
The album you are putting out is called Wait For Me, whereas your latest album, Last Night, was about sex and drugs.
Mm-hmm.
This one is about, well, could we say mortality or...
Yeah, that does seem to be... Like, if I had to describe the record in one word, would give it a theme, mortality would be the theme.
That's a huge way
it's
to...
It's a big...
in well, one year?
Subjective mortality. You know, I'm not describing mortality for everybody. It's just sort of from my own perspective. And when I was making the record, I wanted to make something really... And it's a strange word to use, but I wanted to make something beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've realized of all the records that I have from other people, the ones that I love the most are the ones that are really beautiful. You know, I love fun records, and I love sexy records, and I love dark, edgy records, but it's those beautiful, emotional records are the ones that mean the most to me.
Mm-hmm. Those that are not quite perfect.
Yeah, and also, yeah. I like records that have some imperfection in them.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
So how do I have to imagine that? You were sitting in your bedroom, literally sitting in your bedroom, making this album?
Mm-hmm. Well, I've been in the same building in Lower Manhattan for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
It's a weird building. It was a prison for a while. And then it was a slaughterhouse where they used to kill cows there, and then in the 70s it became artist lofts, and a lot of bands have been in, like Sonic Youth used to have a studio there, and the Beastie Boys and Sean Lennon and Iggy Pop. So it's an old music building as well, and so I have a 2-bedroom apartment. I sleep in the small bedroom, and I make music in the larger bedroom, and I think that's one of the reasons why also the record does have a much more personal quality to it, because I was making the music at 2 o'clock in the morning just by myself.
Mm-hmm. I've read things about this new album, and you saying that you were inspired to make this kind of a record ever since you heard David Lynch talk at the BAFTAs. But was it only that talk? Because it's hard for me to imagine that one simple thing like that can cause such a major change in what music you make.
Well, David Lynch just reminded me. He was talking about art and music, and how the way art and music should be judged has nothing to do with the money it's generated or record sales. The way art should be judged is how much integrity it has and how it affects the person who's listening to it or experiencing it. And I've always known that, but it was just nice to be reminded of that. Because I come from a weird underground music background, and whenever I've found myself having any commercial success, it's been accidental and confusing.
Mm-hmm.
And so with this album, if it's commercially successful, that's fine. But that's not the goal. The goal is for me as an individual to make something that other individuals might get some meaning from.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's almost like the commercial side of it is almost like an accidental byproduct.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because what's precious in me to music is that ability to communicate with one person.
But you did choose, like, the first single to put out is a song that basically cannot or will not be played on the radio,
yeah,
which is a big statement for you.
Well, I mean, I had been signed to Mute Records for a long time, and then Mute was bought by EMI. And so I was an EMI artist for a while, and I really liked the people at EMI, and I had a really good time there. But it's EMI is more of a big commercial label, and so now I'm an independent artist again. I'm putting out the record through PS, Played Against Sam. And to celebrate, I chose the first single from the record. I picked an instrumental song that really can never get played on the radio, and got a David Lynch video that can never get played on TV. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's me sort of celebrating that I'm a true independent artist again.
Mm-hmm. Coming here after, well, you were here last year, so coming back here, you know what to expect, you know the kind of atmosphere there is in the backstage, but does it still surprise you, like in a pleasant way, to be back here again?
Well, yeah, and not to be, I don't know if this word is a word that people would understand, but the word sycophantic, it's to be overly nice to someone. Mm-hmm. But Werchter is the nicest festival in the world. I mean, you talk to other musicians, like every musician on the planet is very happy to come and play at Werchter, because for some, like, the audience is enthusiastic, the stage is really nice, the equipment is great, the people are wonderful, the backstage is great. So yeah, I mean, there's some festivals musicians dread doing and musicians don't want to do, mm-hmm. but Werchter is one that makes, you know, all musicians are happy to be here.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're one of the nicest musicians around, so that's kind of like a match made in heaven.
Thanks.
It is. Are you sticking around to see Depeche Mode?
Do you know, I might stick around. I might have to leave. I'm not sure. Well, part of it is I've seen Depeche Mode probably 20 times in my life. And I actually saw their first show in New York in 1982, mm-hmm. when Vince Clarke was still in the band. So it was, you know, the three of them, Vince Clarke, and they had a little monkey who banged, like a little robot monkey who banged cymbals together.
That wasn't Martin Gore, no.
It was not Martin Gore.
Okay.
So I've seen them quite recently, too. Like, we're playing quite a bunch of shows together. So I might stick around and see them. I like Depeche Mode, but I've seen them a lot.